Hello, everyone. I'm Pete Shapiro, and let's give it up for Dr. Seth Hurwitz.
Sorry, you know, I'm a little shy at these things.
This will be fun. So it's fun. I already changed how I was going to open this because we just met before to chat for a sec, and before getting into, you know, what we're going to talk about, which is always not a good idea, as Seth said, I don't want to talk about what we're going to talk about. The natural thing that I ask a friend who's in the business, who are most of my friends, is, well, A, I noticed you weren't here last night, and so I say, and you guys probably say this to friends, you know, what'd you see last night?
Not music. I never come see music here, actually. I don't like going to shows that aren't mine. People that know me know that. I don't like.
That's funny. I do.
I don't like being told where I can't stand. You know, I mean, that's why I do this. Really, is so I can go where I want.
No. If you guys noticed, Seth, before we just started, was sitting in the front row there, ready for our panel. But what do you do, actually, when you go to a show that's
theirs? Actually, I went to, it's kind of an obscure thing. It's not obscure, it's sold out, pretty much sold out two radio cities. This thing, Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. Has anyone heard of this show? So nobody's heard of this, and it's sold out two radio cities. So it's a TV show starring this woman, Rachel Bloom, incredible talent. And she starred in, sings, dances, and all that. It's like a modern musical, like you asked me, like La La Land kind of thing,
right,
breaks into
which
song.
Is...
And just finished the fourth and last season, and they're doing this songs from the show thing. And so why would I see that? I don't know, it's an amazing thing. It's an amazing show, and it's
what'd you think of Tootsie? I know you just saw that.
Well, Tootsie. So Tootsie, there was a guy in the first season of Crazy Ex-Girlfriend who left and is the star of Tootsie. So I had to see that. And then the night before that, I took the agent for Rachel Bloom out to dinner to Peter Luger's. And that's my New York trip.
See, I'm actually trying
here,
to see.
And
I find seeing theater, seeing musicals, seeing shows based on TV shows.
I don't watch much TV
me.
At all.
No, but I don't watch TV.
I am one of those people that has never seen Game of Thrones. Yeah, whatever. Will not be a topic shortly, will it?
How much time do you spend? I don't get to do a lot of TV because I find when I get home, that is a time for me where my brain, like when do you get to think? And I know we talked before, another thing I learned is Seth just told me that he's never worked in an office. He's always worked out of home, and I worked out of my home until I was in my 30s.
Well, I'm curious, when do you think,
because we both feel you're managing multiple venues, big team, they're all in an office. How much of your time is overseeing, you know, blocking and tackling of I.M.P., and how much are you creating, thinking what you're going to do next?
Well, I used to book everything, and I worked at home. I started in a bedroom at my parents' house. I mean, I started tying up the phone line, and my dad said, you need to get your own phone line, and by the way, you're paying for it. And
what year is that?
I guess it was 1980, and so I worked out of my bedroom, really. So when I moved out, which is when I got married, it's when I moved out of my house. True. I worked out of a room at our house, and then our apartment, and then we moved into a house. And I've always worked at home. Why would you not want to work at home? Why would you want to go to an office?
Well, to interact with other humans.
What does that mean? Well, I was going to say, well, I talk to agents, but that's not really humans.
Well, how do you, your team, who's booking, let's say, 9:30 or planning Merriweather, you can just do it easily just with this thing?
I work, this is my office. I mean, I work wherever I am. I mean, so now I don't really have to go to an office, right?
Right.
I go, it's on my bicycle in the handlebars, and I wherever I'm, wherever I am, that's where I'm working. But I try not to work all the time, but so I don't book anymore. I have people do that for me because I can't take it anymore. So I actually, the only thing left I book really is Merriweather. And I watch the emails fly back and forth, and every now and then, so I have like a shadow account. I watch.
Well, 8 minutes ago back there, you say, "God damn it!" Looking at this thing. So.
Yes. Let me think. What was that about?
You say, "God damn agents."
Oh, that motherfucker. Yeah. Yeah. But I didn't answer him.
What was it about?
Some guy was taking off the us off the routing, supposedly because he wasn't getting what he wanted, which was something stupid. And that's the way this guy always is. But we'll be back on the routing soon enough. No, so I watch, I have it's called a shadow account, and I watch, you know, the interaction between my people and agents, and every now and then I get so pissed off, I'll chime in.
Wait, call it a shadow account.
Yes.
What is that you email address? Is it say Seth at, you know, 930, is that shadow account like it's another name of a fake person?
You know, I could tell you what it is. It's a little pompous, and you guys will take it the wrong way, because every now and then, I do respond, and I forget it's shadow account, because I'll get so pissed off, and I'll say, listen, motherfucker, the last time you played her, you did 300 people, you know, whatever. And everyone will get pissed off at me in my office, because they're like, they're not supposed to know you're watching, and now you've made us look like, you know, mere puppets in your... universe here.
And does the person receiving the email in L.A., the agent or somewhere, do they know the person emailing saying, you motherfucker, is Seth Hurwitz? Or is it a real...
Well, they see the email address.
I'm learning now. And they say, I'm learning.
And they say, whoa, God at 930.com?
Oh, my goodness. I mean, this is good for the kids out there and the people out there, how it's done. You know, just set up an email address called God at the name of your venue and just respond from that.
I can see I'm going to have to change this now, but...
The World Wide Web doesn't...
It's really self-deprecating. It's not that I would actually think that I'm...
I know, we love you.
You know, God.
So that probably is what, in doing this research, I also learned, and maybe it's because of this kind of thinking, but you were a DJ when you were young, and
right.
you got fired from being a DJ.
I did, yes.
Which is shocking after hearing this so far, but what happened?
Well, you know, in those days, if you were a DJ, you were a DJ because of what you played on the radio. You weren't a DJ like, you know, that kind of shit. So,
programming wasn't set out of San Antonio.
You got paid by the hour, you know, it was, you know, you were on the radio. And we had a station called WHFS that was truly progressive. So we're talking 70s. And that was what I wanted to do. That was my goal in life, was to be this DJ on this cool radio station and play cool music and turn people on to what I thought was cool music. So at the time...
What was cool music then for you?
At the time, the cool music was, Jethro Tull or Traffic or stuff like that. And then it progressed and got into this whole, in D.C., a very famous big act in D.C. was Little Feet and Bonnie Raitt and that whole thing. Okay, so I got a job on the station. I was on, in 1976, I was in high school and I was on this radio station. So my dream, I was 18, 17 when I was on the radio, and my lifelong dream had come true when I was 17. So... they kind of got stuck in this Little Feet thing. Meanwhile, I moved on to Lou Reed and Roxy Music and Bebop Deluxe and other things. And they were like, what is this weird shit you're playing? You know, stop it. I was like, well, it's progressive music. You know, you may not understand it. Some of you types here think I'm weird, but you'll see. But they got stuck in that, and I was playing, you know, what was truly alternative and progressive and one day the program director called me while I was on the air and asked me if I could stop by on the way home.
From school or from
work? No, from being on the radio.
And you're doing this in the afternoons after school?
That was Monday night. I had a Monday night shift, 5 to 9, I think it was. So I stopped by his house and found out that, and then WHFS then stood for We Have Fired Seth. So that was the end of my lifelong career.
And then another dream starts soon with, I mean, you put on your pretty, we were just talking that for me, it happened a little later. I had an incident happen while I was at college at a Grateful Dead concert, of course, that got me here. But you is different.
Wait, it was supposed to be a conversation between, I'm supposed to ask you all this stuff too. So how did you get started?
I have to drink some water now.
Actually, that doesn't even talk about the concert business. That's just what I used to do.
No, I went to a show. I grew up in New York City, but I wasn't, at the end of high school, I went to some Jane's Addiction shows, My Bloody Valentine. I saw at the Ritz, now Webster Hall is a great, when they played that 40-minute note, I was there. But I wasn't a huge music guy. Went to college in Chicago and started playing a lot of Frisbee, Hacky Sack, learning about the Grateful Dead, which you do in college is great. And then I went to a Grateful Dead concert in March 9th, 1993. I know at Rosemont Horizon. I was just going with friends. I had been to one at Giant Stadium the summer before, but never really been to something like this. And I just...
How many Grateful Dead shows have you seen?
Well, now I've... There's just so many different versions of it, but...
The original.
The original Grateful Dead, probably about 30-ish, ended up going on the road. But I went to Rosemont Horizon, they had Ken Nordine, spoken word. And I was flying around a little bit, and they started walking Nordy during the show. And it just freaked me out, and I left the show. And, if you're like 21 and first time ever hearing that with the what Dan Healy was doing to the audio in the room, you might leave also. So I left, went to the parking lot. It was snowing, and looked around, and I just lost my friends and never seen anything like what I had seen before. And I still don't think there's anything like it. Where in the parking lot was like the circus had come to town. It was kids my age-ish, but they were not going back to Northwestern. They were definitely not going home. Yeah, some of it was a party, but they were like searching for to be a part of something. We've actually talked about community a few times today. But there was a scene going on. You know, all the school buses, bonfire dancing, lights, noises, sounds. And I just couldn't believe it. So I went back to college, and for the only time in my life at Doors for the library, which was like 8 or 9 a.m., I was online before Doors for the library alone. You know, there's no one. And I started doing research, what had been done on this scene. I was a film kid. And I went 6 weeks later on the road to try to capture that. You know, I'm still chasing it, maybe. That was magic. And that got me here, really. But you didn't have one moment. I actually believe if I hadn't gone to that show, if I hadn't left in the middle, I actually don't know. I would not have gone to the library the next morning. I would not have gone on the road with the dead, making a film about it. I would not, where Larry Block, who owned Wetlands, saw the film. And that's how I got wet. It's crazy, but I actually don't think I'm here. I was not on a path to go do live music, you know. But you were a little, right? I mean, you.
Well, I was. Then I went from that station. I was on the radio at a Georgetown station, which was a funny station called WGTB. And Georgetown University had this station that was so radical. Nobody on the station went to the school. It was just crazy people. Doing that had taken over the station. And they figured out the priest.
It's a great radio station for a college. Like, no one goes here.
No. So the Jesuit priests figured this out at some point and shut the thing down. But at the time, that was a place to go and do a show and just keep my name on the air. But I did a talk show, and I interviewed rock stars backstage and whatnot. Pretty interesting. Went in a lot of interesting... situations there, but
give us one We're going we'll to get back to
Bon Scott, AC/DC.
I can just
opening
see Seth's eyes.
Kiss.
You guys can't looking at me. I know there's something good. Give us one.
You know, like Bon Scott, AC/DC opening for Kiss at the arena, stuff like that. Looking back now, pretty wild. But I was supposed to interview this promoter, the local promoter, and the station went off the air before I got a chance to, but I ended up working for him. I always wanted to put on a show. I don't know why. It's just the same reason I wanted to play records for people in school or on the radio or just, I don't know. I just always wanted to present music.
Didn't you team up with a teacher?
What's that?
Didn't you team up with one of your teachers?
Oh, that, yes. Yeah. So
your first
I had a substitute teacher, 10 years older than me. And if you remember substitute teachers, when you're in school, you'd come in and you'd have like the ones that couldn't wait. This was their day to be the greatest teacher ever and would lock the door and teach you whatever it is they wanted to teach you that day. And you hated them. And then you had, people that did this for God knows what reason, money maybe, I don't know. And this guy was, he was a music guy and he would have his stack of music magazines and he'd say...
So he was cool.
He was cool and say, I don't care what you do, just don't get in trouble. And him and I used to like go out and get high and he'd let me drive his car. And I think I was 15. Or so, I don't know. We had a lot of fun.
It was the 80s.
This was late 70s. Yeah, 80. And then...
It ain't like that anymore.
Well, it may be, isn't it?
It's true.
Just you see it online, that's all. It's instantly, there's pictures of it. But so then the promoter had this theater and he gave it up because he was booking things like, this was like a ghetto movie theater. And he took over that had a stage in front of the screen and he was booking Doc Watson there. This did not work. So he gave it up. I made a deal with the new owner, and I said to my friend, my substitute teacher, hey, you got any money? Let's put on a show. So,
how much did you need? Did you think?
I remember at the time, but it wasn't that
You had
much.
It right? Well, but I'm curious, when you first were like, first show, here's the number, were you pretty
You
armed?
Know, it was, we did a combination movie and concert, and the first band I booked was The Cramps. And they canceled a week ahead of time. And so we put on a bunch of local bands, beefed the bill up a bit, and the movie premiere, and it was kind of a gimmick, concert and movies, and we made money on the first show, so, oh, well, this is easy. And then the next show, it's kind of like, the casino, you win and you stay at the table, and then you lose it all.
And how'd you promote a show then? It's 19... Late 70s, early 80s.
You know, you gave out posters, you bought print ads, you handed out flyers, you sold tickets in record stores.
And the agents then? I mean, you're like
Well, that was
teenager.
Ian Copeland. So Ian Copeland, does anyone here remember Ian Copeland? So, there was this guy, Frank Barcelona, premier talent, and he was the big, I don't want to say mob, I don't want to say that word here, but he had the big system for the big promoters and told everyone what their territory was and you're going to get these acts, and he had this system for the big promoters. And I came along after that, and I wasn't allowed in that system because he had already set up the players and the rules. But Ian Copeland came along, and his brother was Stuart Copeland, the drummer in the Police, and his other brother was Miles Copeland, the manager of the Police, and he had all these cool alternative acts, which is like all the ones I wanted to promote anyway. So he set up his own little system of alternative promoters, and the same deal was, you do my acts when they're small, and you can do them when they're big.
And who was the boss of DC? Who had Frank Barcelona?
Well, it was Jack Boyle, and... they saw me doing these little funny little acts and thought, well, they'll never get big.
You must have loved that.
They'll never get big, and if they do, we'll just take them from them anyway. So these acts got big, and Ian Copeland would say, well, go put the arena on hold. And I was like, the arena? Really? Me? He was like, yeah, just go call the building. We'll do the show there. So he pretty much without flinching, said, yeah, we're going to do
these. So you're renting venues. You're putting on shows. You're doing it at the movie theater also.
Yeah, and then the 9:30 opened by this woman named Dodie. And we realized we had to do his small acts in the 9:30 club. You need a place to do small acts. So we started doing them there. And then we made a deal to book the whole club. And then she sold us the club. This is, you know, this is a long time ago already.
That's what we want to hear. So you take over 9:30.
Yeah.
What did you do when you got it? Because you had been doing shows there, you take it over. First time you, like, a room is yours, and you get to control elements that you cannot always just renting it, putting on a show, but you're not running it. What are a couple things that changed when you took over actual ownership of the 9:30?
Well, we got to lose all that money ourselves.
And how'd you flip that?
Well, so...
Because that changed, or...
The 9:30 Club, if you only lost 100 grand in a year, that was a good year. I mean, it was a loss leader to do acts when they were small so that you would do them when they were big. And Dodie, you know, she lost money and didn't do the acts when they were big, so she had no reason to keep the place, so she sold it to us.
But we know the 9:30 today makes money. I just know it.
Well, we moved the 9:30. So the 9:30, the old 9:30 was about half the size of this place. I mean, it was tiny. The stage was in the corner, and it was a place.
Right, and irony is when you have 4 or 5, when I had Wetlands, the cost of putting on a show in a 500-cap room, 600-cap room, versus 1,000, 1,200-cap, a lot of them you have. I mean, that's why it's tough to be the little guy. You still need a sound person. You still need someone to book it. You still need production.
We would lose a lot of money. And it was a terrible, you know, smelly, rat-infested place. It was, you know, we would constantly be apologizing for it, or not apologizing. We'd say, isn't this charming? It's a cool place, right? It's got vibe, right?
Yeah, Wetlands was charming and had vibe.
You know what? I was asked, when CBGB's closed, I was asked to say something at the eulogy, and... I actually spoke after Tina Weymouth. Her niece works here, apparently. And at the time, I was practicing more improv and not writing things down on what to say. So I didn't think of what to say until right before I went up there. And they were talking about how rat-infested and horrible CBGB's was. And I thought, I got up there and I said, you know, I only met Hilly Crystal once, but I want to thank him because... When people would come play the 9:30 after playing CBGB's, they would be like, this is pretty nice.
So you moved in 9:30, you get to create your own room.
Well, what happened was the Black Cat opened, which was nicer than the 9:30, had maybe less rats, smelled less.
Still going.
So it was a little nicer, and then all of a sudden, all these people that I thought were my friends were not my friends. And they went and played there. Realized it was show business, not show friends. And
why do you expect friends not to go play any other rooms?
Just for more money, yeah, that were supposedly...
I mean, you're more relaxed, right? Let's be honest. You're relaxed.
Well, no, I mean,
your
it's a hard
age,
lesson
but
to learn.
That used to get you riled up.
I mean, you have bands that play for you,
yeah,
right? Work places. With you. You think it's because they like you, right?
Of course.
You think you have friends, right?
Yeah.
And if someone opened a place next door and offered them a little more money, and you've worked with them for a long time, and now they're playing next door. How would you feel?
Well, what you've done is create a vertical situation right now. They never really have to leave you.
Well, what you have to do is to create a situation that they need so that if they play next door, you take away their toys or something like this. So
you guys are learning from the best, by the way, at this stuff. And there are not many like that, but how do you take away a toy?
Well, you have to have something that, you know, if they do something that you don't let them do something that they can't do. If you have to have something over there, you have to leverage, you know.
By the way, it's Seth's Amphitheater, the Merriweather Post Pavilion in D.C. A year or two ago, Seth installed a pool backstage, which I think classifies as a toy. But what, is that just to basically compete with Nice, the pavilions that Live Nation's got, that you want to go one notch and say,
well,
how important is that?
We don't have the leverage on the amphitheater level to beat amphitheater tours. So that one was tough to beat. I famously sued them over that, and that didn't turn out so well. But it was a lot of fun.
Would you do it again? You would. Right?
I would, because if I didn't do it, I would always regret not having tried. I mean, I had to try.
And that was about what? That the city of Silver Spring, Maryland.
No, that's a whole other battle. I mean, we got a whole list of these, but that was another one I had to try, right? I mean,
and what the try would be to go through the legal process to try to.
Well, that was a different issue entirely, but the amphitheater thing I felt was a monopoly, a antitrust issue. But so
what'd you do?
What did I do? Well, I've recently made a deal with them to do their tours in my amphitheater.
Oh, but before that, what'd you do? You sued them. How did you, you know, who'd you hire? What'd you do? I mean, you've gone up toe-to-toe with big guys and actually gone through suing them. You know, so I'm just curious what you're, and were you advised by close friends? Were you supported? There were people saying, yeah, good call, go for it. Were people warning you, saying, Seth, you probably don't want to do this?
I got a lot of people patting me on the back saying, good for you. I don't know if they would have done it. But there were people saying, why would you, you know, why? I mean, I've had my whole life people telling me, why are you causing trouble? Why do you do these things? When they turn out well, people say, wow, man, you got a lot of balls, and wow, that's really great that you did this, and good for you. When you don't do it, it's, boy, are you fucking stupid. You know, when you don't succeed, it's like any, in sports, a manager.
It's kind of like this place for me.
Yeah?
And for us. Yeah, well, when we were building this in construction, we had Ron Delsner came to visit while we were in construction. We looked around. I'm like, Ronnie, the stage is going to be over here, and the lanes are going to be over there. And I always use the band Galactic because it's a New Orleans vibe. Galactic's going to be playing the bowling and the food. And he's like, Peter, you know, come here. We got to talk. So we like walked into the corner, and he put his arm around me. And he's like, I'm worried about you. Like, what the fuck are you doing? It's a goddamn bowling alley next to the fucking stage. No one's gonna fucking play here. Are you sick? He thought I was sick. I'm worried, and are you sick? So I had people warned, but it's interesting how much when you come to a show here, you don't hear the, you know, you people, a lot of people thought it wouldn't work. And what's interesting is how much it did work.
How did you know that would not bother the bands or anything?
Well, you don't really know till you try it. I mean, that's the truth.
Well, how do you try it without building it?
No. I was fortunate. We were fortunate to be in a position to raise the money. Had done enough to get to try it, and that's so much of life. I feel bad for people.
I know, but here you had to try something bold, right? And it's like in history. Who got anywhere without trying something different? I mean, I don't want to sit here and applaud ourselves. And I hate it when I go to these things and there's people up there talking about how successful they are, why they're.
We both failed in different things. You can fail too.
I can talk about you and you can talk about me. That's okay. No, but seriously, it's like, and I've talked to people out there back when we used to let in all ages. We always have. And people would talk about how, you know, it's terrible, you can't let in kids, or we do an all-ages show. It's like, I think you can, and I think it's actually against the law to not let people in all ages. Restaurants let in all ages people, they sell liquor. I think you can do this. And everyone would say, whoa, no, you can't, or, you know, I don't know, we can't. It's like, you can, you just have to. So when you're up here and you tell people, and I asked you who comes to this, indie promoters, new promoters, I don't know who's out there really, but, you know, fucking take chances, you know. That's the only way you're going to do anything unless you want to work for someone else. And I've worked at home my whole life in shorts, usually no shirt, and it's not a pretty sight, but it's comfortable for me. And a cat on my lap, usually. It's great. It's the best. It's a privilege to work for yourself, but you got to take chances. You have to do something nobody's done. Put a pool in the backstage or whatever. And by the way, I mean, that does, the reason that I was able to make a deal with Live Nation to do their tours in my building is because
you had a pool and they didn't.
Well, bands want to play my venue. Right. I had to have a venue they wanted to play, or I had no leg to stand on whatsoever. So I at least had to have a place people wanted to play, or else what leverage did I have? And that's the leverage there. With the 930, what happened was, so the Black Cat was kicking my ass, and I thought, you know what? I'm going to build a club that ends this argument once and for all. I'm going to build the fucking best club in the world. I'm going to reinvent this shit. So this was before House of Blues or anything. We invented the mega club. We were the first. Well, I want to say probably the Ritz in New York was a big club, but that was sort of born that way. It was already shaped that way and everything. But we invented the, you know, Camden Yards of nightclubs. And I was just telling that story to someone. You know, if you remember old stadiums, when you'd go to stadiums when you were young, I don't know if these people are that old, but you go to these stadiums and they were made of concrete, seats are uncomfortable, but you accepted that. This is when you go to a stadium, it's outside and the seats are uncomfortable and it's ugly and it's not comfortable. That's what a stadium was, right? Yeah. And then Camden Yards came along, they were the first,
padding and stuff,
to say, well, why should it be uncomfortable? Let's make it nice and comfortable and good food and, you know, why not? So we did the same thing with a club, which was, all right, it should have great sight lines, great acoustics, good food, lots of access to bars, everything, great bathrooms, that sort of thing. For women, love great bathrooms. And, you know, just reinvented everything. And
did you have the adjustable capacity from the beginning then, too?
Well, so that was the thing. You know, the reason I got all this history on bands, which doesn't matter as much these days, but back then it did, was because we had the best small place. So we realized if we built this big club. And by the way, this was a place where we used to do shows. It was a radio station called WUST. And it was, God, I don't remember, it was built a long, long time ago to have their gospel broadcast. In fact, it was owned once by Duke Ellington. And but it was old and just a giant hall. And so we gutted it. And
it's 96 you reopened, right? The new one?
Yeah. So we knew that, but that's 1,200. We wouldn't get the small acts, so we thought, well, we need a place that can also be small, right? So we thought, how do we have this stage? We need to be able to make the place smaller, but we never want anyone to know that it was cut down, because nobody ever wants to play a cut down building. So how do we do it? Do we have screens on the balcony? We never want the balcony to be closed because we never want someone to say, oh, it didn't do well, the balcony was closed, or bands to feel like it was shut down. And so we have the stage at, well, let's move the stage closer. We had this guy that worked for us at the time, this guy Chad. Now, Chad was a guy that was the janitor at the old club. Total grease monkey, you know, looked like a homeless person. But if you talked to him, you realized he was a fucking genius. So you'd say hi to him. And
was he the one with the idea for the moving stage?
Yeah, yes. So he invented everything.
Does he have a royalty?
I don't even know where he is now, but
I hope he's watching the stream. Just email me. I'll get you in touch with Seth, Chad.
No, so
that was a big idea.
Chad was the kind of guy you'd stop and talk to, and you'd go, he's like a smart guy. So we're sitting around a meeting, like, well, how do we, he says, well, why don't we just move the stage?
Like, I just want to say one thing. It's an amazing, because the obvious is obvious.
Yeah.
Until you miss it. Hold on. Moving a stage, I mean, the 930 Club's had a run since 96. Let's just, to be honest, call a spade, has sold probably more tickets in that venue for its size, definitely than any other venue in the country, probably the world. And it's a great room. I've been there. It's awesome. But the movement of the stage was essential to what's become. And other people, that's a pretty simple idea. And no one had.
Well, so we were like, how do we do it? And wow. So we put like a conveyor belt, you know, some kind of hydraulics, or how does this work? And Chad was like, well, just put wheels on it.
Right.
Oh, well then, how do we, you know, do we pull it with cables or what? And he was like, we'll just get a couple guys to move it. Oh, and that's how it moves. So, now, Chad being the mad genius that he was, actually did have some fun with it, and the lights and the backdrop move with electrical, all kinds of crazy shit that he invented. But and so the room shrinks and all that. So, and if you walked out and then we moved it and you walk back in, you wouldn't know the difference. You can't tell. So the 930 always looks full, and that was the trick there.
And then you did that again at Anthem. Like,
the Anthem is different. We just so the thing with the Anthem was we wanted the same situation. Anthem is a new venue we opened. It's 6,000 capacity, but also...
What can it go down to?
2,000, and it has a reserve seat setup of 2,000 to 3,000. So, again, we spent all this money to make it smaller if we need to, but in that, we add on to the stage because it's a real proscenium stage. You can't move it, but we add on to the stage and the backdrop moves, and again, you got this $1 million system in the ceiling where everything moves. But so we did the first night, and there was a radio station giveaway only for the Foo Fighters. They played two nights. The first night was just a promotional, listeners free, and that was only 2,500 people. So 25.
Did you shrink it?
Well, we didn't, and 2,500 people filled the place out, and it looked absolutely full. And we sat there and we said, fuck, we didn't need to spend all this money. It's full at 2,500, it looks full, we didn't need this. And so we very seldom do that, except when a show really stiffs.
Right.
Like
this room can
Phil
work.
Lesh, if you remember,
a couple hundred.
We built the stage out.
This room actually can work in a couple hundred. I mean, well, it helps you know what works, because
you're
a musician. There.
You didn't laugh at that.
I was thinking of the next thing. I want to talk about how you're a drummer. I'm sorry. But you threw me when you went into Foo
Fighters.
That
was Peter's show, you see, Phil Lesh.
Oh, yeah. Now I get it. Okay. He did. We did a little more. I did the second show there, Jesus.
We had fun.
Oh, we had a great time, yeah. But you are a musician. No, we had fun. I mean, one of the things that's cool about this business is your friends, a lot of ways. There isn't really a line.
You wouldn't play the place next door just for more money, would you, Peter?
Not with you. I mean, there's no line between work and friends for us.
You remember those photos I have, right?
I get a call every year from Seth, usually from an agent, being like, Peter, you got to talk to Seth. He's fucking losing it. And it has to do usually with Lockin in Virginia, which is like 3 hours away from D.C., and there's something, and I look forward to those calls, because I know one day I look back. I actually keep it with me. I'm tempted to put it on the mic here. I shouldn't. Maybe I should. I think this phone call, I've saved the voicemail for 5 years.
This is good. I don't know anything. I have no idea what this is, but I can't wait.
No, it's... Actually, it looks like... I'm not going to play... It's... I feel like I'm missing one of my messages. No, it's from Ron Delsner from years ago. But I'm not going to go up to it. I save good voicemails, but you can,
okay.
Do
you
it.
It's okay. You can do it. I'm fine with it.
It's fine.
I regret
but
nothing.
But you're very upset, and you're very powerful in conveying how you feel about that. But I am curious, because we both had the opportunity to renovate venues.
Do I seem like capable? I'm calm and nice, right?
You are. Actually, you've gotten calmer and nicer. And you look rested. So actually, we should talk about that. But you are. You now you're collaborating with all different types of people that you wouldn't have before. We resolved any time the lock-in thing. We're joking, but we get there. We're just reasonable. We figure it out.
Oh, was it a lock-in issue?
Yeah. Jason Isbell.
Oh, yeah.
But we figured out. But like, how have you managed? You have kids that are now grown. But it's true. You had a bit of a reputation, we'll say, for sometimes having a temper. A little. It was effective. You can't get here, you know. But now, like, how do you manage that? You've been doing this almost 40 years. How do you endure the endurance game, the health game, the, like...
Doing, you said for 40...
You're almost at 40 years, dude. Sorry to tell you that. Yeah, like...
Oh.
But you seem, you were excited. We sat down, and you're in it right away.
Well...
In a good way. Enjoying it.
I am enjoying it. I'm having a lot of fun. I don't book anymore. That's probably one reason I enjoy it. I will tell you how. It's kind of personal, but since you asked, I meditate every morning, 20 minutes. And then I read a bunch of things.
What do you read?
Philosophy, nonfiction, history, just things to learn.
Not industry blog, email.
Never. Fuck no. So I used to get up and open the computer and start working. And that's just not the way to, for me, anyway, to exist. So I just center myself and... priorities, you know? And then when I'm goddamn good and ready, I'll work.
So, wow, that's... I always think I gotta... I tried meditating, I gotta do more of that, but
I don't like to, I don't like to preach.
Just hearing you. I know, I'm looking at you. Your eyes, you look fresh, you're into it, so you're into the... You're still... I hope I'm like this, Inge. You sat down and we went right into it. You're not like, hey, let's talk about other shit. You still love this shit. And I still love going to shows. Where we differ is I love not going to my own shows. Because when I'm here, I'm in at my own show or other at the Capitol, I'm always seeing things that I want to be better.
I have a house. We have a house in Austin, Texas. I love Austin, but not for the music. And I actually said in an interview once, they said, oh, do you go to music when you go to Austin? And I said, well... That'd be kind of like a gynecologist going to a strip club. I mean, it's just not... not what I want to do on my time off.
What show do you most regret you didn't get?
You know, okay, so he asked me that earlier and I had time to think about it, but, well, there's a lot of shows the shows I regret... If I don't get a show because I just didn't get it, because I competed and didn't get it, you know, you have to learn to get over that stuff quick. I would say that meditating has helped with that.
There's one that you haven't gotten over.
Because you got to move on. You can't let that shit drive.
Or is there an experience, like a fest? Is there an idea you had?
One thing I learned a long time ago, thankfully, when you're negotiating. So I remember Spinal Tap toured, and a friend of mine managed them. And so I had an in, and I had this thing lined up, but then I fucked around with the deal. And I thought, because he's a friend of mine, I can lowball and start low, and I blew the deal, and I didn't get the show, and I regret that. And the thing I learned about that was...
Don't fuck around too much.
Don't ask your friends to take less money. And, you know, then you're not being their friend. And
when you make an offer for a band, Do you come in to get it closed? Or do you come in and leave room?
Well, it depends on the agent. There are agents that you know that if you give them what they want, you're done. Not many, but there are some. And there are ones that you know just play games, and you know as much as you'd love to just give them what they want, just get it done, you have to play this stupid game because they're always going to come back at you. And you, to negotiate in this business successfully, you have to learn each agent's behavioral pattern because they're all different and they all have one.
Who's the best? You've done about 40 years. Who was the best agent for you to work with?
Well, there still are some of them.
Here or not here?
Well, you know, Chip Hooper was a great guy. And the thing I loved about Chip was that he told you the truth. Just you asked him a question, and that's what he told you. If you were getting fucked on something, that was the answer. He didn't sugarcoat it. It was, what's going on with this? You're not getting it. Oh, I mean, well, you're not getting it. But can I just, you know what? Get over it. You're not getting that show. And he'd tell you why. And, you know, because I deal well with reality. You know, give me the straight story, and then I'll deal with it. You know, don't give me something vague, because then you go off and you wonder what it is. And so that's how I'm big on the whole do unto others thing. And so that's when people ask me a question, I try to give them a straight answer. And because that's how I want to be dealt with. So, you know, I like, I don't want to name names because
Chip Hooper works.
Chip Hooper works.
Yeah, I got no one more because we're going to get to some Q&A. We're almost done an hour. It's going by.
Who do you like to deal with?
No, I have one. You know, I was going to ask you like one moment where you were standing side stage. And the opposite, you're like, fuck, this is great. I'm psyched and proud of putting this on. And we actually share something in common. We both did our first show in a stadium at the same time, because when I did Fare Thee Well at Soldier Field in July of 2015, you were doing the Foo Fighters for your first stadium show at RFK in D.C.
Yeah.
So what's a show, maybe it was that one, maybe it's unexpected. Like for me, I was just thinking when I was thinking about asking you in case you pushed it back. We got to host Aaron Neville's 75th birthday here. And we've done some amazing things here, like Kanye and Adele or Paul Simon and Jane's Addiction and all this stuff I could have named. Like, oh, it was Perry Fair, you know. But during Aaron Neville's 75th birthday, you know, it hit, and we had Dr. John here. That really might have been for me here, because, like, you're not hosting Aaron Neville's 75th, especially after, like, what Ron Delzer said.
But when you're working with an act that you were a fan of, especially before you were a promoter.
Well, that's the Grateful Dead stuff, easy.
Yeah, I mean, so we do this metal fest at Merriweather every year, and it's really funny. I mean, it's because it's just people come out of the woodwork and wearing black and things they shouldn't be wearing. And from that era, I mean, that maybe they get stuff out that they wore back then, and it's quite a sight. So headlining, they've headlined this before, but it was Whitesnake. So Whitesnake, the lead singer is David Coverdale. When I was in high school, I was really into Deep Purple, and he used to be the lead singer of Deep Purple. A lot of people don't know that. So I saw Deep Purple at the Capitol Center, the original arena, when I was in high school, and he was the lead singer, and now I'm promoting Whitesnake, you know. And so I go to meet him, and he's super nice, very together, looks great, and we talked about that, and he was trying to remember the opening act, and I remembered it, which was Nazareth. And he's like, well, how old are you? You know, I was like, well, how old are you? You know,
And you're talking to him while another part of your brain's being like, I can't believe this is happening.
This is crazy. And then a year ago, I saw Dear Evan Hansen on Broadway here. And this guy, Ben Platt, the star, you're in New York, you know all about this, right?
I saw it.
Phenomenal, right? So Saturday we did Ben Platt at the Anthem and did 3,000 people. And I got to meet him and talk to him. And it's like, this is just fucking great. I mean, you know, what a life. I go see a show and then I'm doing the guy at my venue. And it's just, you know, this for me is the joy of all this. And the Foo Fighters at RFK, you know, O'Dave is from Washington. So without sounding name dropping, I mean, everyone there knows him. He makes a point of being down to earth and coming home and going to the club and hanging out with everyone all the time. So when we were putting that show together, it was the Sonic Highways tour. So, you know, and we were standing on the field at RFK. We were doing some promo shots for the tour, and he's like, who should we have open? Let's have the Slicky Boys. And the Slicky Boys are some no-name, you know, act that can't sell 200 tickets now. And I'm like, Dave, you see all those seats there?
Okay, you gotta sell them.
You want people in those seats? Okay, we got to think a little bigger than that. He's like, all right, well, that's your job. Come up with shit, you know. I was like, okay. So then I had this idea, like, well, what if we had greatest, like, someone from each show from each city that he did the show from each, you know, like a greatest hits. And so I texted him later that day. I was like, here's my idea. He was like, that's fucking great. I love it. And then his manager texted me later that day saying, Dave has an idea. Excellent. Great. Do it. So so they put that show together, and it did 50,000 people. And
wasn't Joan Jett on there or something?
What's that?
Was Joan Jett on that?
Joan Jett?
It was Joan Jett, right?
Yeah.
See, I was in Chicago and paying attention.
Yeah, but they said she was from L.A., and she's actually
that
from...
That wasn't from any prep. I just remember that.
That was the
Chuck
L.A.
Brown?
The L.A.
Chuck
actor.
Brown?
She's from Wheaton, Maryland.
Right.
So that was... Anyway, that was a great
I want to keep going. I have a couple more things, but we're going to go to Q&A because I want to let... Okay, cool. There's someone here up front. I see. Okay.
Hello, my name is Kathleen. That was awesome. I could just like listen to you talk for hours, both of you two. You have the gift of gab. My question to you is, what advice do you have for people who, you know, want to open venues? Like, I grew up listening to bands like Green Day, like with the DIY scene. Like, what advice do you have for folks that want to get involved in actually having a venue?
Well, you have to do something that people aren't doing. So if you try to open a venue or do anything that's already being done, you're gonna get killed. I mean, that's how I survived, was to create situations that nobody else had. And otherwise, there's no reason people are not gonna play for you just because you love music more than the other people, or you get it, or, you know, I realized that early on. It's just, you're not gonna get a show because you're the biggest fan. You have to have something they want that nobody else has. And if you do have that, you will win. That's my advice.
It's pretty good. Okay, another one. Anyone in the back? Is there some?
Hey, guys. Thanks a lot for this panel today. It was really insightful. My name is Richard Davies. I'm with Hedgehog Entertainment. I've been lucky enough to be able to book some great shows over here at the Brooklyn Bowl and also at Garcia's at the Capitol Theater. After everything I heard Seth talk about booking, you know, I'm very happy to be able to work. I'm honored to be able to do something like that. In general, thank you very much for arranging this concert, Pete. And also to Seth, I've been to the Merriweather Pavilion. Dear Jerry, what a fantastic legendary time that was. What a legendary venue it is. But I want to ask you guys, both mentioned how you were inspired by music, and that's certainly live entertainment and live music is what has put me into the field of management, booking, and expanding our services and doing more for our clients and our artists. You guys went from those experiences, Seth, you mentioned doing progressive music, something that got you started here, but when things really start speeding up and you find yourself in the business world, and what type of experience you guys had getting there, what would you relay over in your experience that was the most important thing to get on track so you could move from an organic environment? Yeah,
yeah. Mine, I would just say try to stay flat, even. Like when things start speeding up or slowing down, because they go both ways. So if you go too far up on a good night, Aaron Neville, 75th, Foo Fighter, you know, like if you get too up, something bad, something, it can change so quickly, especially today. Things move, and then you can't get too far down. Like when I was doing fairly well, and when we started before the event, you know, there was lots of sidewaysness going on and hazari, and like, but rather than freak out too much, I really kept reminding myself to focus on the event and focus on like the details of making the event great, because no one had seen the event yet. And when it was over, all people would remember is the event. And now, like when I'm walking down the street or an people in the airport, like anyone says something like, hey, you know, it's incredibly powerful what happened and to them, whether they were there. And part of it was like, well, if you're not going to be there, we're going to stream it. And you're going to get to experience it in a way. And like that worked in the end. People who were not there but went to maybe Brooklyn Bowl or home or a party and watched it, they loved it. But beforehand, they're like, that sucks. I didn't get a ticket. I don't care about a fucking stream. And they tell us that. But afterwards, all the people remember is how the event was. So my advice would be like, try to stay even. If things are growing, like you just said, scale, you know, don't get too far up, or you'll screw yourself, and don't get too far down, because you need to focus on making it work, because that's all that matters really in the end.
Well, and similar to that, that's good advice, because the experience, and it's all about how good the show is, you know? I mean, it has to be, we're in show business. People need to go and escape and have a great time, and it needs to be a great experience, and that's really the bottom line. And if anyone saw that Fyre Festival doc, I mean, that, you know, and this Woodstock thing.
That was not a Seth Hurwitz production.
No, this Woodstock thing seems to be heading in that direction. But
we could keep going and start talking about Woodstock 50, but maybe we should.
No, my advice is don't do stupid deals and think they're going to come out okay. Okay, so, you know, you can't negotiate reality. It's people all the time, you know, and agents. The thing I learned very early on when I lost money on a show was that nobody else gave a fuck about my welfare. Nobody cared if I stayed in business. It was remarkable. It was like, wait a minute, I'm part of the food chain here. How can you not care if I survive? They don't. They really don't. And, you know, they're not going to do a deal because it makes sense for you. So if a deal doesn't make sense, if you're working on a show or whatever business you're in out there, and it doesn't make sense, don't do it and think somehow it's going to work out. And that Fyre Fest thing is a great example of this.
It kept, because he was so deep.
Because it was like somehow it was going to work out. And everyone that worked on it thought, well, this guy can't be that stupid. I mean, he wouldn't get this far into it if it somehow wasn't going to work. No, it can not work. And don't kid yourself. Don't talk yourself into thinking that this is somehow going to work when it clearly doesn't. You know, it's like, that's what I've always avoided.
What if you're not sure?
What's that?
Like this play. Well, what if you think it's going to work, but you're
not
sure?
But that's different. People are telling. If you run it in your head, like when we opened the 930, or when we opened the Anthem, or took over the Merriweather deal, I ran that deal in my head over and over and over, and the scenarios, and to me, it worked. It doesn't work, but I'm going to make it work. No, I ran it over, and I said, okay, I think this works. I know what the break-even is, I know what the nut is, I think I will never miss that payment, I think I'll always at least break-even, I think it works. But if it didn't work, I wouldn't have said, yeah, it doesn't work, but somehow we'll figure it out. No, don't do that. You will be out of business. I mean, you may get lucky, but more than likely, you will not. And I've seen so many people and so many promoters. And that's why a lot of these promoters ended up having to sell, because they got themselves into situations where it didn't work, but they somehow thought it would. And it's just, don't do that, you know? Just, and the other lesson in that, one of these things, one of these books I read.
It's going to be our final lesson, so make it good.
All right.
We're going to wrap. No, I'm giving you.
I'll give you a final lesson.
That was a good show. I'm teeing up my partner, let him know. We're in a closer here. Good luck.
Okay, I can't take credit for this, but I, you know, some of these things are because of I read all these books on an iPad, so you can highlight shit and save it. And one thing I came across recently was, you know, just because things are going well doesn't mean that you're in control.
Right.
So, anyway.
Okay. Thank you, guys. That was fun. That was awesome.